Begin by welcoming everyone, and I think we should, in the before we even light a candle, we should just breathe together. The air is so bad here. Carol says it's bad in San Diego. How is it in Claremont, John? Is it bad?
Well, I haven't suffered from it, but people who work outside and so forth.
Right, yeah. Right. And okay, so let's just take a moment to breathe and be grateful for our lungs and for our air and this beautiful air that we all share. Okay, we can light our candle, and we light this candle and ask for God's blessing for all of those who are suffering in these times of terrible fires. And to give guidance and protection to all of those firefighters who are helping them in this time of great disaster.
Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Okay, so we have some invitations. Next week, we are going to have a celebration for Hildegard. It is her feast day on the 17th, so we will be celebrating that next Sunday, and I invite you. It was her tradition that she invited all of her nuns in her community to dress up and wear jewels and let their hair go down and all of these radical things in the 12th century for feast days. This was her tradition. So we think of, you know, there's one movie I've seen of Hildegard where she's, you know, wearing a habit and everything is dark. And I mean, the woman talks about color and greening and the beauty of creation. So you can just imagine how colorful she must have been. And so I invite you to do the same. Dress up next Sunday. And I'm going to make these wonderful cookies, this cookie recipe that Rose has found. They're stress cookies Hildegard has offered. So at any rate, that should be a time where we can really celebrate creation and say many prayers for all of those beautiful creatures that have died, the millions of acres and the plants and the trees and the animals and the people and the just a horrific, horrific kind of destruction. So I think in this time of great destruction, it will be very, very life-affirming to remember the spirit of Hildegard and ask her spirit to be with us. So there's some links here to the class that we did, if you'd like to review any of those. And Matthew Fox has this wonderful Hildegard pilgrimage. If you'd like to join, you can look into that. And then the following Sunday, Carol Ann Joyce is going to be creating a angel worship. It is the Catholic tradition to have a celebration, a feast day of the angel, archangels, Michael and Raphael and Gabriel. So that is coming up. And then we have our weekly programs. And are there any other announcements anyone has? Okay. And
Tuesdays at 9 o'clock, Lexio Divina.
Yes, Lexio Divina. We have our Bible study here and centering prayer every Tuesday morning. And we will begin with our invocation, and we say our prayer to the Mother Earth. Our dear, dear Mother, daily provider, Earth be your name. Time has come to honor you, to know you and to show our love. Give us each day our daily grain, kissed by the sun and kissed by the rain. Teach us now to find a way, care for you and our work and play. Our dear, dear Mother, daily provider, Earth be your name. Time has come to honor you, to know you and to show our love. Hi, Eleanor. We're so happy you're here. Eleanor's here for the first time, and we're delighted you've joined us. And we usually have a time where we share and introduce ourselves at the end of the service. So we'll look forward to hearing more about you. Eleanor's joining us from just a few miles down the road. And we are going to invite the angels to come forward. And Rose cannot be with us today, but she had a grandbaby, Celeste. So we send blessings and prayers for Celeste, a new life that is here in our community. Angels, welcome in this sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, we'll be a living sanctuary for you. Okay, now we have a song that I want to just introduce, and I think this should become our theme song. This is a song from Mamma Mia, written by ABBA, and the lyrics are, I have a dream, a song to sing to help me cope with anything. If I see the wonder of a fairy tale, you can take the future if you fail. So I think this is what we're trying to do here at Church for Our Common Home. The idea is that if we can imagine and we can create a kind of a paradise that we want to have in our very troubled world, if we can create that very crystal clear in our religious imagination, in our hearts, in our spirits, if we can work toward that, if we can put our energies towards making that come into birth, if we can do that, even if we fail, we will have contributed something very important. And then the lyric is, I believe in angels, something good in everyone I see. And I changed that. I want to let you know it's the real lyric is everything I see, but I think we're talking about creation, all life forms. So it's everyone, all the creatures who are living and who have an inner life. And I believe in angels. I know the time is right for me. I'll cross the stream. I have a dream. And it's so interesting to me. I'll cross the stream, which is across cultures and religion. People talk about crossing rivers as a very important metaphor, a symbol for going to the other side of all kinds of passages in our lives. So I think this is a wonderful, we will sing it more with Carol. I have a dream, a song to sing, to help me cope with anything. If you see the wonder of a fairy tale, you can take the future. Even if you fail, I believe in angels, something good in everyone I see. I believe in angels, when I know the time is right for me, across the stream, I have a dream. I'll cross the stream, I have a dream. I'm so glad I can see some people know the words and they're singing along. So please, everyone, unmute and let us all just hear one another's voices. And I say, remember, God loves us. There's nothing we can do about it. And let's just greet one another in a cacophony. Christine, I'm
hello, everyone. Glad to see you. Yeah, it's great to see everybody today.
I love all you.
Yeah, God does too. And he's not stopping. Nothing you can do to make God.
Hi, Jennifer. Hi, Sean. Are you in New York?
And all creatures everywhere.
Our puppy, Tom. And he is, he's here with us, and he is a great blessing. Well, it's wonderful to be with everyone. Mm-hmm. And thank God we can be together in this time of catastrophe. Oh my gosh, so many catastrophes. It's unbelievable. And we have no choice but to preach the good news and to thank God for all of our blessings. So we are going to now read our 12-step program, and I'll begin, and anyone can share. And please, let me just assign it ahead of time so we don't have to wait. Jennifer, if you would read the first six, and if Angela, you would read the second six, and we'll just take it from there. Church for Our Common Home is God-centered and guided, dedicated to the earth, loving community, beauty, and the arts. Our vision is to create an artistic, ecologic church to love and pray for Mother Earth and the John Cobb Biodynamic Farm. We work for an ecologic civilization with our 12-step program.
Okay. Number one, share the truth that the current sixth extinction of life on Earth, the only one created by humans, is an invitation for transformation as a human species. Number two, share the history and human habits of dominance over relationships and commit to relationships of collaboration, partnership, and co-creativity. Number three, make amends for our alienation and abuse of the natural world and our idolatry of scientism and rationalism using transdisciplinary reconnections of religion, art, psychology, ecology, etc. Number four, explore eco-feminist and process theology, celebrating God and goddess language, symbols, and relationships. Number five, study the teachings of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, including newly found Gnostic scriptures and the world's ancient wisdom traditions. Number six, offer diverse spiritual practices to develop loving relationships with the natural world, Mother Earth, and all creation.
Seven, honor the invisible realms of dreams, prayer, intuition, parapsychology, and imagination. Eight, celebrate the visual and performing arts, ritual making, beauty, and creativity as divine spiritual practice. Nine, celebrate intergenerational community by intentionally including and honoring the very young and old. 10, encourage consciousness raising with integration of body, sexuality, mind, spirit, feelings, intuition, and imagination. 11, work for social justice locally and globally in partnership with other organizations. And 12, experiment with non-traditional church in order to create relevant, spirit-filled, and loving community.
All right, and let's everybody give a hand to Angela. She does the most beautiful work. It's so beautiful, Angela. Thank you so much. And not only is she created this beautiful, beautiful order of worship, but she's taking Martha's place, and she's going to be our at the head of the board, doing everything important. So thank you, Angela. And it's just such a blessing for our small church that we have young people like you, Angela and Tony, who are not scared off by all this technology. So we're so grateful to your ease and grace and inspiration of all these technologic things that I would never think of in a million years. I said to Angela in a text today, thank you for your eagle eye. She noticed something that was wrong and fixed it. And then she sent me this little photograph of an eagle. It was just the cutest thing you ever saw. So at any rate, we're just so grateful for all of your gifts. And this past week, as if it wasn't enough for us to have all of these forest fires and have the current global problems everywhere, I don't know if you're aware, but it was the end of the 19th anniversary of 9/11. And it's a terribly horrible kind of anniversary. There's a wonderful book, and it's called The United States of War is what it's called. And it's horrific what has happened before, during, and after 9/11. And of course, some of us on this call believe that it was actually perpetrated by the United States government, 9/11. So at any rate, I think it's so important as we are talking about forgiveness today to really try to be truthful and to look at the harsh truth of the empire in which we live and the devastation. So this is a beautiful song, and we're going to sing it first, Finlandia, This Is My Song, and then we'll sing it later in the service, Be Still My Soul. So I'm hoping that you know this song and that you can sing along. This is my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for lands afar and wide. This is my home, the country where my heart is. Here are my hopes, my dreams, my holy shrine. But other hearts in other lands are beating with hopes and dreams as true and high as mine. This is my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for lands afar and mine. This is my home, the country where my heart is. Here are my hopes, my dreams, my holy shrine. But other hearts in other lands are beating with hopes and dreams as true and high as mine. My country's skies are bluer than the ocean, and sunlight beams on clover leaf and pine. But other lands have sunlight to clover, and skies are everywhere as blue as mine. Oh, hear my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for their lands and for mine. Kevin, would you do us the favor of reading the scripture?
Peter came up and asked Jesus, sister or brother wrongs me, how many times must I forgive? Seven times? No, Jesus replied, not seven times. I tell you 70 times seven. And here's why. The kingdom of heaven is like a ruler who decided to settle accounts with the royal officials. When the audit was begun, one was brought in who owed tens of millions of dollars. As the debtor had no way of paying, the ruler ordered this official to be sold along with his family and property in payment of the debt. At this, the official bowed down in homage and said, I beg you, your highness, be patient with me and I will pay you back in full. Moved with pity, the ruler let the official go and wrote off the debt. Then that same official went out and met a colleague who owed the official $20. The official seized and throttled his debtor with the demand, pay back what you owe me. The debtor dropped to the ground and began to plead, just give me time and I will pay you back in full. But the official would not hear none of it and instead had the colleague put in debtor's prison until the money was paid. When the other official saw what had happened, they were deeply grieved and went to the ruler, reporting the entire incident. The ruler sent for the official and said, you worthless wretch, I canceled your entire debt when you pleaded with me. Should you not have dealt mercifully with your colleague as I dealt with you?
Thank you so much, Kevin. And you know, it reminds me of watching tragedies, you know, on stage. You know, I worked in the theater for a long time. And there gets to be a point in any tragedy where you want to just say, stop, everybody, stop. It doesn't have to end this way. You know what I'm saying? There's a sort of a momentum of there's going to be revenge, and then there's going to be this continuation, and then there's going to be all these bodies on the stage. And you know in your heart that there is another way. This is really tremendous. I heard this gentleman, David Vine, interviewed this week, and this book he's written, and The Cost of War, which is I think Brown University. It's so you cannot fathom the numbers. I mean, there are more people, I think, that have become refugees since 9/11 that are in the state of California. And one thing I'll say also is, what this leaves out is, what about the ecosystems? What about the animals? What about the air? What about the plants and the animals? That's not even in these kinds of calculations. So the amount of destruction that our country is in, the kind of empire, it really is very helpful to study the teachings of Jesus, because it is definitely in the context of the overwhelming evil of the Roman Empire. And there's a tremendous amount of how Jesus is teaching the peasants, who don't seem to have much of any chance against such a huge empire of force and brutality and horror, but he gives them hope. So I think in our small church and in our studying the teachings of Jesus, that we can also be given hope. And there will be, of course, just tremendous continued death and destruction, but it's not the end of the story, and there is another way. And as Margaret Mead says, don't think that a few people can change the world is the only thing that ever has. It was 12 disciples that started with Jesus, and there has been a tremendous amount of peace and love and justice that's come from that movement. Walter Wink, who we started with a few weeks ago, talking about Jesus's third way. The third way is, we are not going to respond to violence with violence, and we're not going to respond like a doormat and lie down and just let violent people take advantage of us, or aggressive people, or bullies. We're going to find a third way, which is very important that we have supportive community to be able to strategize and how to find that. And there's a deep amount of inner work that has to be done. And Walter Wing talks about how it's just not been publicized. We don't have a good education about all the successful kinds of nonviolent revolutions that there have been. And he has a list that goes on and on and on. And I want to just say the first three I thought were so important, because they have everything to do with what my sensitivity is and my intuition is right now as a grandmother who started Church for Our Common Home and wants to create a safe harbor where people can come to be safe, and where people can learn to live in alternative ways of peace and justice and harmony with the earth. That these were three, the three first that he lists were all very much women led. And the first is from 1350 BCE. That's a long time ago. The Hebrew midwives commit the first record of act of civil disobedience by refusing to carry out Pharaoh's order to kill Hebrew babies. So if they can do that then, we can do that now. And we have to stand up and say, no, we are not going to let you continue to kill all of our babies, not with your wars, not with the poison in all of the air and the water and the earth. We cannot allow it any longer. So we need to take hope that people have dealt with impossible situations historically, and they have risen to the occasion, and they have organized, and they have learned creative ways of peace and justice. Antigone is a play that I was in. I didn't get to play Antigone. I got to play her pretty sister. That was a disappointment, but it's a profound story about a woman who says, no, she defies the king. She says, I'm not going to let you honor my brother in an honorable burial. And she goes and she buries him. And of course, the king is going to have to kill her because, and so it's a very, very courageous woman. And then, of course, Liz Estrada is one of my favorites. Liz Estrada is a very funny play, if you haven't seen it. And this has been done not just in ancient Greece, it's been done in modern times, where women said, if you don't stop going to war, I'm not going to have sex with you any longer. And this has actually worked in history. So I think if it worked in ancient Greece, it has modern times. They tried this in Colombia to quite a lot of success. And then, of course, we have to go to the Quakers, who have done such a tremendous, they have been such leaders in the peace movement. And this began way back in 1780 that they started the Anti-Slavery Society. And of course, we know the great inspiration of Gandhi, who began this nonviolent revolution, which tumbled an empire. So if he can do that then, we can do it now. And of course, we know we're much more familiar with Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement. And of course, we have Greenpeace. There are many, many, many of these. I've just listed a few that it has adapted nonviolent methods to protect the environment. And they've done a lot to save the whales. And they are continuing to do creative work. So I lift up that there is a tremendous amount of success in doing things in very countercultural ways that we are just not getting the right information about. And so much of our problem is that we are not well informed in America because our press is just owned by a few corporate entities. So we have to, but we have the internet. So, you know, we can indeed get lots of information on the internet, but alternative kinds of sources. Okay, so forgiveness. Jesus is saying we have to forgive, not seven times, but seven times 70 is so many times. It sounds like he's talking about it's got to be a whole practice. Okay, it's not like a one-time thing. It's a practice we need to learn. So how are we going to do that? It is so difficult to forgive. It is so, so difficult. And I have a sense that we need to make the connection that the ways in which we have not been able to tell the truth as Americans about the harm that we've done, not just in white supremacy, but it's coming out. It really warms my heart that the story of slavery, the story of the genocide of the Native American and the African American people has been coming out in recent months. And it's very inspiring to me that we are going to be forced into looking at more of the truth of our history as America. And there's no other way that we can be involved in the kind of truth and reconciliation to move away from those systems of oppression and tyranny and horror and violence, unless we face the truth of what we have done, what we have been a part of. So as Martin Luther King was very articulate about, we have now Reverend Barber and the Poor People's Campaign, who's continuing that the racial crimes against humanity have been intertwined in our war economy here in the United States. And too often, I think people just don't think internationally or globally. I don't know what that is. I don't know why, but we are a planetary home. Everything we do affects everything else. And this empire that's been based on terror and revenge and punishment, we have many wisdom traditions. Jesus is one of them that says we can find different ways, and that we must find creative ways. Now, Walter Wink is such a profound teacher, and he talks about how in his peace work, in order to learn how to become nonviolent, we have to learn how to forgive. How do we do that? We have to go deep and do deep inner work. And when we have icons like Martin Luther King, we are told by Walter Wink and others that he had a presence of fierce courage, that we can only imagine the kinds of depths of inner work that Martin Luther King had to have done to be able to have not only been nonviolent against people who were trying to kill him, but also was able to forgive them. Okay. Now, we don't forgive people because what they've done is forgivable. It's not. It's not. It's that we cannot not forgive them in order to be free of the violence or the aggression or the harm that's been done to us. So I was so heartened to be reminded that Walter Wink talks about using his dreams as a way in which he can go deep within in order to understand his own wounds. Because of course we have to be able to heal our own wounds. We have to be able to be honest enough to see our own wounds if we are going to begin to heal them. And he writes, "I cite these dreams not to expose myself, but to indicate that the transformation process is not something we initiate. God initiates it in us. We do not grit our teeth and try to be better. We simply cooperate and pay attention in the case by recording the dreams that God provides and reflection on them as part of our spiritual discipline." And of course, dream practice is just one of a myriad ways that God is prompting us into a new reality. Walter Wink says, "The God who speaks through dreams more than 100 times in scripture will speak through them today." And God uses our wounds and the steps toward healing to turn all of us outward towards others, so that those wounds are far more serious to others. Others who have wounds that are far more serious and evident than our own. What he says, "I have learned through all of this, is that God does not use us despite the ways we have been injured, but through our injuries. Without the wound, I might have been simply a superficial, satisfied materialist." Do you understand what he's saying? He's saying, and I know this is true in my own personal life, if I had not gone into therapy and, you know, gone on a deep religious dive, I would still be, what does he say, a superficial, satisfied materialist. As an American, that's what I was. And I needed a great personal tragedy and trauma and aggression to come into my life in order for me to go and search for the teachings of Jesus. And I went to seminary saying, "I want to kill my ex-husband. What am I going to do?" And I did. I learned how to forgive him. It's a complete miracle. If you had told me when I was in the thick of my own personal trauma that I would be able to forgive my ex-husband, I never would believe you in a million years. So I feel like I really got my money's worth at seminary. I went with a specific aim. I went to learn how to forgive, and I was taught how to forgive. And what I have learned is that we can't do it without God. We can't do it by ourselves. It's much too difficult. You can't go with a tremendous wound, somebody who has, you know, and the intimacy of a torturer and those of us who have been tortured by them is pronounced. We can't give that up unless we have the help of God, a prayer life, spiritual disciplines, be it Bible study, be it service to others, be it dream work, be it artwork. We can't do it unless we have the support of God in prayer and we have the support of loving community. So I really know that what he's saying is so important. And we don't do dream work or any of these spiritual practices kind of a, it can be used as such terrible spiritual bankruptcy to just continue self-preoccupation. When we get to the point when we realize that we heal our own wounds so that we can be of service to heal others and help others with their wounds, which are probably often worse than our own. Okay, so I offer some of this, and I want to know that this forgiveness, that's how it's wrapped up in the hurt of our own lives. And I know I have to share that I have been tremendously concerned about my children. And what I've come to understand is that I can forgive my children for being the satisfied materialists that they are. It's very important that in that process, I forgive myself. And it is so important that we begin with self-forgiveness, because it's just a truism. Until we can learn the harm that we've done to ourselves and others, be honest about it, and have the support from counselors or ministers and God, until we can do that, we cannot forgive others. So I offer Desmond Tutu as a beacon of hope. For as he says in his book, there is no future without forgiveness. And he writes in our meditation, it is crucial too that we keep remembering that negotiations, peace talks, forgiveness, reconciliation happen most frequently not between friends, not between those who like one another. They happen precisely because people are at loggerheads and detest one another as only enemies can. But enemies are potential allies, friends, colleagues, and collaborators. This is not just utopian idealism. The first democratically elected government of South Africa was a government of national unity made up of members of political parties that were engaged in life and death struggle. The man Nelson Mandela, who headed it, had been incarcerated for 27 years as a dangerous terrorist. If it could happen there, surely it can happen in other places. Perhaps God, Desmond Tutu writes, chose such an unlikely place deliberately to show that the world, it can be done anywhere. And if you know anything about Nelson Mandela, he was in prison for 27 years. And he forgave his jailers and he hired them in his government. So if he can do that, then we can. But it is not for the faint of heart. Nelson Mandela, like Martin Luther King and other people like Lema Gbowee, who we've talked about, who led the peace movement in Liberia. She was a woman who was living in tremendous domestic violence, and she worked both at the same time. Her personal problems with rage and hurt and trauma, as well as rage and hurt and trauma in her community. And we can do those simultaneously. And we as Americans need to do that. We need to see that the harm that's been to us personally and our families, of course, it's the same harm that's perpetrated by our empire. It's based in systems of punishment, revenge. And again, it's like that tragedy I was talking about. It's like it just goes on and on and on and on and on and on and on until someone does the inner work to say, the buck stops here. I'm not going to perpetuate these cycles of aggression and violence any longer. This is a picture we have right here of a world map showing all the Truth and Reconciliation Commissions at this Museum of Memory and Human Rights in Santiago, Chile. And they're all over the world, these Truth and Reconciliations. And it works. And the secret is people have to tell their stories. We cannot get over traumas without telling our stories and having people bear witness. And we cannot forgive others until we tell our stories, until we express our feelings, until people can bear witness to what we have suffered. So our Christianity, it's a story about a man who was tortured and murdered. And his message is the message that love is more powerful than suffering and death. And if Jesus can say, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do, on the cross as he is being tortured to death. This is not something we are called to do today, but it is the direction we need to walk. And we need to know and be reminded it's possible. And we can't do it without God. And I suggest to you, if you just think it's just, I can't do it, I just can't do anything that difficult. As an old acting teacher, I just suggest, act as if you can and just walk forward. So this idea of 7 times 70, he's talking about not something we do one time. He's talking about a way of life. He's talking about a different countercultural way of life, that we forgive people and we forgive ourselves, even though what they're doing is unforgivable. And if we have ever had a time in history where we need this to be a practice, it is now. So I offer you that as the good news of the gospel, that we can indeed. And I'd like you to write a letter of forgiveness to yourself, okay? So I'd like you to get a piece of paper sometime after services tonight and begin writing a letter to forgiveness to yourself about all those things that you think that you have done that are unforgivable. And I want you to begin the process of naming those things. And I invite you to email them to me or give me a call so we can talk more. Okay, so we have a time that we can be in prayer together. And we have a prayer here. We pray for all of those who are being affected by the fires. And if you will respond, God, hear our prayer. We pray for all of those animals who are suffering in these fires. God, hear our prayers. We say prayers of blessing for all of those humans that are helping other humans in these times of fires. God, hear our prayers. We list those names of all of those we have to forgive. Holy Spirit, come and be with us. Open our hearts and minds that we learn to forgive. Help us to follow Jesus' way of love and forgiveness as best we can. Fill us with devotion to your gracious God, and we ask your angels to protect and inspire us. Pray for us, Holy Queen, Holy Mother of God, for we come to learn how to forgive, to love our enemies, to judge not, to live in radical peace. Help us, guide us. Pray for us. We give you thanks for we can see and hear. We give thanks for we can walk and talk. We give thanks and will promise to serve you and follow in the ways of forgiveness and love. We ask for your help. We ask for your blessing. Amen. And we can sing on the same song with different words as we prepare for our silent prayer.
Be still, my soul. Our God is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. While God dwelt below. Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on, when we shall be forever with our God. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgone, love's purest joy restore. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall meet at last.
Let us be together in silent prayer. Amen, shalom, and blessed be. And please unmute and let us share all names together of those we pray for as we ring the bells.
David, Sean.
And Eric, whose birthday is today.
Jeannie.
It's the most.
Oh, man. Met with and
Joe.
Big Prim as he helps with the fires.
Pat. Terry,
Joey, and
all the health workers, all the hospitals,
John Robinson,
and the police,
the Toya Robinson,
police in every city and every town,
the Kemba Hilton,
all of the creatures fleeing from the fires and all those burned by the fires and all the plants, all
paramedics and firefighters,
destroyed by the fires,
Brian Del Cerro.
The creatures in the ocean.
Into a rut.
For my friend who lost her, 2/3 of her state.
I want to share a story that Walter Wink shares, that he was with a group of people who were intractable. And they were two groups, and they had tortured one another, and there was just no way they thought they would ever be able to forgive one another. And at the end of their meeting together, when they decided that it was beyond hope, they would never be able to forgive one another, they prayed the Lord's Prayer. And we usually say this prayer, which is an adaptation of the Lord's Prayer. But what happened in the story is they say the Lord's Prayer, and when they got to the point where they said, we promise to forgive, they stopped in the prayer. And they said, I guess we're going to have to forgive one another. So I'd like to just offer right now, let's just all unmute and let's join together in the Lord's Prayer, which we don't usually say together, but let's unmute and do that today. Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, let thy kingdom come, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give to us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the
from evil. Amen.
And the glory forever.
Forever. Amen. We have our spirit of St. Francis and St. Clare. Make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. And where there is sadness, joy, joy, joy. God grant that I may not so much see to console as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. The Lord is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Benediction that I heard this week, Father Benedict Rochel, and he said, I asked Ruby, why are you always smiling? And Ruby said, I'm so grateful to God for everything I got. I can see, I can hear, I can walk, I can talk, and when I'm all finished here, I'm going right up to heaven like a shooting star. So let's sing our musical benediction, and then we will have an opportunity to be able to share together and share how we're doing in these very difficult times. May the blessing of God go before you. May her grace and peace abound. May her spirit live within you. May her love wrap you round. May her blessing remain with you always. May you walk on holy ground. May we all go in peace.